Most people who buy estate cars buy medium-sized ones. And in fact, medium estate cars now account for some 6.5% of all new cars sold. The latest contender in the medium estate field from British Leyland, the Austin Allegro Estate. Now, this is very much a three-door car rather than a converted van with windows. Leyland's researchers indicate it's likely to go to the private owner rather than the fleet operator, and they hope it'll win back the sort of customer who used to buy the old 1300 Countryman, discontinued about a year ago. Unlike some estate cars, the rear seat comfort is ample, as indeed is the headroom. Now, with that rear seat in place, there's 10.25 cubic feet of load-carrying capacity without getting in the way of your rear view. Turning into a full estate is simplicity itself. You merely lift the squab here and then, using the central release lever, one, down she goes. Now, in this condition, you've got 53 cubic feet of load-carrying capacity. Now, both those statistics are almost identical to Ford's Escort estate. But here's the big difference. Remember, the Allegro is front-wheel drive, which means that there aren't any rear-wheel drive components that can intrude into this low, flat, and very useful luggage-carrying area. The usable distance between the wheel arches is 43 inches, which makes the Allegro at least the match of its competitors in this group. It's certainly extremely high at the back. This is to accommodate the rear door's opening mechanism, which being up in the roof at least doesn't interfere with the loading aperture at all. The rear side windows don't open, always a shame we reckon, but there is through-flow fresh air ventilation. But practical or no, one has to say the appearance is slightly odd, if not ungainly at the back, certainly an acquired taste. Part of the very comprehensive standard package, screen wiper and washer for the back window, which on a flat back estate like this always attracts lots of road dirt. Under here, either the old familiar A-Series 1300 overhead valve unit or the Maxxis overhead camshaft 1500, both thoroughly proven for some years. The best features, superb underbonnet accessibility for all the serviceable items, everything from the wiper motor to the starter solenoid. Full marks for such attention to detail as the way the wiring loom is secured to the body shell, with all the clip tabs carefully sheathed to prevent chafing over the years. Like the Allegro saloon, the estate has the same front-to-back connected but fully independent hydrogas suspension system, which gives it a characteristically bouncy ride. In fact, in a crosswind, and with this body shape, I found it rather choppy, but totally absorbent nonetheless. Also included in the price, about £20 worth of full inertia reel seat belts. The original Allegro quartic steering wheel, that was that squarish shaped thing, has gone and been replaced by a much more convenient round one. Fingertip controls here, really at your fingertips, very well positioned indeed. And I particularly liked up here, lots of spaces for those odd oddments that seem to accumulate. The most vital statistics, petrol consumption, well, between 32 and 50 to the gallon is possible on the 1300 engine, between 28 and the 45 mark for the 1500cc. Price from £1,880, that's for the 1300, £100 more for the 1500. Both are still cheaper than the smallest Maxi, and Leyland forecasts that they'll be selling twice as many 1300s as 1500s.
A two-door, four-seater baby car with a 1-litre engine, the newest member of the economy car alternatives. Obviously encouraged in no small part by the success of rival Datsun's 100A, the most popular imported car in Britain, and almost repeating Mazda's 1000, this is the smallest Toyota from Japan's largest vehicle manufacturer. Yet, unlike the front-wheel drive Datsun Chery, a thoroughly conventional front engine driving the rear wheels has been chosen. It's priced at £1,158, and apart from its fellow Japanese competitors, by the much cheaper and smaller Fiat 127 from depressed Italy, as well as from Renault's R5, a 1000cc Mini from British Leyland, and particularly from Ford's 1100 engine Escort, which is only £5 cheaper, and surely due for a replacement at any minute.
It's aimed especially, I reckon, at those people whose pockets are forcing them down to a small car, and yet who don't want to sacrifice some of the items of specification that they got used to on larger models. The interior treatment is far from economy. The seats recline, A radio is thrown in. In fact, the only two suggestions I've got to make are that the combined two-speed wiper switch and electric screen washer, and very good it is too, that control is moved to the column so that you have fingertip control. And the other point is that they fit a wing mirror here on the side. Much like the Corolla 1200, but a 1 litre overhead valve 4 mounted fore and aft and inclined to the near side, not only for the best maintenance accessibility, which as you can see is first class, isn't it, but also to achieve a low centre of gravity. Sealed cooling and servicing only necessary every 6,000 miles. Well, I've been finding it's really entirely happy on only 2-star petrol. Well, as for the rest of the hardware, there's McPherson struts and anti-roll bar and disc brakes at the front. Radial tires are standard, a 4-speed gearbox, a prop shaft leading back to a drum brake rear axle. In fact, it's all utterly straightforward. The petrol tank, instead of being underneath for rear impact reasons, that's behind the rear passenger seat, though it's separated from the luggage area by a rather tatty piece of hardboard, which I think I'd like to see changed. The jack, well secured, yes, but it does tend to dig into the luggage and the top of the spare wheel too. I think it needs some sort of boot flooring of some kind. Still, nonetheless, a good-sized boot. And the petrol tank, by the way, that's got a jolly useful capacity. It's nearly 9 gallons. Frankly, the performance is nothing special, although I have been finding you can cruise all day at 70 if you want. The average fuel consumption, that's worked out at just over 40 to the gallon. The other thing that must be mentioned, and that's the very good job they've made of making things really very quiet inside. Little mechanical or road noise getting through to you. I must say I half expected the handling to be of the kamikaze order, but instead it in fact has perfect manners. Really very good for an economy car. Yes, considering what it is and how much they want for it, the verdict has to be value. And although the European manufacturers are mumbling in their beards that Toyota are merely discount buying further market penetration, one can't help feeling that they're now more than well on their way to repeating the Japanese motorcycle success story. Research for safety, research for the market. The car they claim that can mean anything. Sporting? Well, semi-sporting coupe. Family? Small family saloon. And compact, that's true, estate. Vauxhall tell you it's whatever you want it to be. Yet, as with any vehicle that tries to achieve extremes of compromise, it could so nearly qualify for the Jack of All Trades Master of None award. Nearly, but not for very many customers who've been taking to the all-round versatility of the Chevette. Indeed, in a very short space of time, really, it's become Vauxhall's largest volume seller. Just in time, really, too, because the Viva's certainly been losing ground, particularly to Ford's new Escort. Having to fulfil so many entirely different needs, in a way it's surprising that the Chevette's British styling actually comes off. But it does. It's not at all awkward, is it? You land up with a very streamlined estate, starting with its droop snoot front end, obviously borrowed from Vauxhall's recent, considerable and successful racing involvement. However, I personally don't rate the styled headlights. They're not all that good at night, and they're just waiting to scoop up and retain all the dirt, not to mention the snow. The motor, our old Viva friend, the 1256cc four-cylinder, disappointing technically, a bit dull perhaps, only the valves overhead. But nonetheless, it is thoroughly proven, and as I saw on the last Total Economy drive, at least capable with concentration of 45.3 miles per gallon. Brakes, a disc drum layout, servo-assisted with dual circuits, very effective. Front-end suspension independent with coil springs and an anti-roll bar. At the back, though, ye old live axle, but coil sprung and with an anti-roll bar. As far as the luggage space goes, with the rear seat in the usual position, you have 12 cubic feet. But with it folded forward like so, a state car form 35 cubic feet. That's not bad, but with the fuel tank and the spare wheel beneath there, any high luggage does tend to restrict the rear view mirror.
Another thing is, the criminal will can see exactly what you've got in the back. What it ideally needs is some sort of pull-over tonneau cover device to hide things away. On the L version, you get opening rear quarter lights, which I think are absolutely essential. Two doors only, and on the L you also get cloth upholstery. Ample leg and headroom inside, considering the sloping rear to the roof, is not too bad in the back either. I like the lane change position on the indicators, the competition type steering wheels just right, very comfortable, and the intermittent wipe facility. Now that's additional to your two-speed wiper and electric screen wash. But a couple of not so good points: the seats, they take far too long to recline, and the safety release button under the column here, that's to prevent you being able to accidentally withdraw your keys on the move, thus operating the steering lock, they can prove extremely painful for the knees. The price, £150 more than the standard Viva two-door. Most people, though, will be buying the Chevette L, like this, which costs £1,742. On the road, a very commendable lack of road noise gets through. And apart from the very high standard of finish, certainly on the test models I've tried, I suppose the best feature has to be the handling. It's way above average for this size of car. Very well balanced suspension, steering and braking. And obviously at last, Opel Kadett influence has had its effect. The drive-in verdict? The Chevette is the best
Vauxhall. If you had to climb into a car here on the Normandy cliffs of Cap Blanc Nez and drive all day down to the south of France, stopping only for petrol and snacks, and expect to get out of the car feeling as fresh and alert as when you'd started, you would have had to have chosen a pretty special set of wheels for the trip. Well, having done just such a trip a few weeks ago from Frankfurt down to Turin for our show report, I think you'd be pushed to find a better car than the one I used, the Mercedes-Benz 280 SL. However, this particular car, the SL body, fitted with the well-proven six-cylinder engine of the 280 range, is new to Britain. And perhaps it's an indication of the way buying habits are going, even up in the rarefied heights of cars costing over £16,000, that economy is becoming such a potent watchword. Not that the 280 SL is a slow economy version of a fast car. Mercedes have always been past masters at extracting a lot of horsepower from every cubic inch of their engines. The 280 SL, with fuel injection and twin overhead camshafts, produces 185 brake horsepower at 5,800 RPM, and that's enough to speed the car along the autobahns at nearly 125 miles an hour and to accelerate from 0 to 60 in only 10 seconds. As an indication of how effective this combination is in performance terms, the car's big brother, the 380 SL with a 4-litre V8 engine, is only 1 second quicker to 60 miles an hour, and its maximum speed is only 9 miles an hour greater than this car's. Mercedes drivers always pick up the impression of security and safety from their cars. No one, of course, wants to have an accident, but in a Mercedes saloon, you're in just about the best protected position you could be. And the convertible goes as far towards that ideal as it can. In the first place, the sheer weight of the car, around 1.5 tonnes, is an indication of the built-in strength of the massive body shell. With crumple zones front and rear, centrally mounted petrol tank, huge side members, and rollover protection in the screen pillars, all you need to do is strap yourself in. And don't let anyone kid you, you shouldn't use safety belts in an open car. Brakes are massive and they're fade-free. They took a fair old hammering on the Alpine passes and they never complained. But the impressive thing about these cars is the ease with which they take their corners. No stress, no drama. Inside, the Mercedes is comfortable, but it's without being sumptuous. At first, the seats feel too hard. You need to sit in them, I think, for a long period to appreciate their design. And there's plenty of room for two, for stowage, although I wouldn't describe the boot as overgenerous. Instruments and controls, well, they're well designed, they're simple, they're well engineered. The seating position of the pedals, just right for me. And the power steering isn't too light, and it allows the driver to really feel the road. Heating and ventilation, well, they're both tremendous. Putting the roof up's a pretty complicated performance, but once it's up, it's taut and it doesn't flap and drum at speed. Now, there can't be too many people around who want to spend all this money on a two-seater coupe, but those who do have a pretty limited choice. BMW don't have a two-seater in this price range, and the sort of driver who'd go for the Mercedes is unlikely to look at the Ferrari, Maserati, Di Tommaso class of exotica. Jaguar's XJS is the obvious competitor, although, of course, you can't take the roof off a Jaguar. Of course, no car is perfect, and the Mercedes is no exception. There's rather too many shakes and rattles around the hood area for a car costing such a lot of money. And I think the engine's a bit noisy and fussy at low speed. And can any car that's only got two seats be quite so big and heavy? But if I was in the position of making such a choice, I must confess I'd be really torn between
this... It's not really very
this...
surprising that the sports saloon has ousted the sports car from the common market. Not very surprising when you consider that northern European weather has never really been on the side of the hood-down two-seater motorist. And not really very surprising either when the sports saloon category throws up cars like the BMW 2002. A motor car which will travel as fast, if not faster, than the old sports car, will carry more people in spacious and more comfortable surroundings. What is perhaps surprising is that such a large share of this profitable section of the market should have gone to imported continental cars. Cars like Italy's Alfa Romeo and Lancia a few years ago, comparative rarities on our roads, now gaining almost mass acceptance. But don't worry, at last there is a British contender in the field. And here it is. And this, the latest from British Leyland, is the Triumph Dolomite Sprint, the sports saloon that doesn't just compete with the Continentals in terms of performance, but in some areas actually beats them. And the key to the performance, as ever, lies under here. Here, a new 2-litre version of the Leyland Dolomite Saab 1854cc overhead cam 4-cylinder unit. But it isn't just the increase in capacity that's put the power output of the Dolomite Sprint up from 91 brake horsepower to 127. The secret to that lies here, within the cylinder head. And if you could look at it from underneath, this is what it would look like, with 4 valves per cylinder instead of the usual 2. Now, the idea of having 4 valves per cylinder comes from the fact that increasing the valve area also increases the amount of mixture that can be sucked in, used by the motor, and expelled again within a given time. So, more power. It's as simple as that. Triumph engineers came up with the idea that the maximum possible area of 4 valves crammed into the combustion chamber is greater than the maximum possible area of 2 valves. It all results in very competitive performance indeed, which we'll come on to in a minute. But let's start by looking at some of the other more obvious changes within the Dolomite Sprint. Starting at the front end, where there's a very fashionable spoiler to keep it glued to the deck at speed. There are new alloy wheels from GKN with 5.5-inch rims and wider, lower-profile tyres than on normal Dolomites. Vinyl coverings are stuck on the roof and rear pillars, coach lines down the side, and at the back, dual exhausts and a Sprint badge. Inside, more comfortable seats, now finished in bright nylon broadcloth, and full marks for this. Turn the black knob, and you have a steering column that will adjust up and down, like so, for height or in and out for reach. And while these stalk controls move with the column, when it's in the down position like this, it's in fact very difficult to see the minor instruments. Oh well, on with the belt, and let's attend to the business of performance. On a test track like this, 115 miles an hour would be possible, quicker than all its competitors apart from the Alpha GTV. But this, of course, for us road-going mortals is hardly relevant. What is useful is the 0-60 time of just 8.5 seconds. Only Ford's much more Spartan RS1600 and the far more costly fuel-injected TII version of the 2002 can get there any quicker, and then only marginally. As for what it all costs, over our tests we've been averaging about 23 miles to the gallon, which is really much the same as all the alternative buys. By the way, on the Sprint, overdrive on third and top, as well as automatic transmission, are optionally available. In fact, really, just one criticism, and that's some occasional deviation from the front end when being attacked by crosswinds. And finally, the price. And once again, we're at an advantage. At just under £1,800 on the road, the Dolomite Sprint probably represents the best value in sports saloons at the moment. In fact, with foreign car prices continuing to rise, there seems little doubt that this product, this offering from Coventry, will almost certainly oust the BMW 2002 from Munich as the number one seller in this field. At this moment, you'd be paying £600 more to buy German, and for that you'd be getting two headlamps and two doors less.